every time it's different. We don't have bells, anything, you know, big, small guys. Everybody has their own experience. Lots of boxers comes, judo practitioner, sambo. Every time you check yourself how good you are. Because every time you see a person in front of you and you want to show him movement, you check yourself. Because it's like you are in a minefield.
This is Glenn Murphy with NC Systema, and this is Systema for Life.
Vladimir, good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for this interview.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure, always. Great. So can you tell us a little bit about where you're from and what your background is?
Oh, yeah, I'm from Russia. Born in Russia, and the city is Tver. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I was a little bit more than 30, I just came to Canada. And that's it. Meet my wife. And now I'm here.
Great. And you studied both competitive and military style martial arts. Is that correct?
Yeah. I was 13 when I started to do box, and then in army, of course, we studied some martial arts, but it was hand to hand combat, I believe.
Yeah.
It was more belong to military application, how to work with a rifle, with a knife.
Yeah.
And then I met Michael and did a karate competition. It was fourth in Russia. But now some people tell me I was third, you know. I forgot already. Yeah. Anyway, it was good competition. Yeah, anyway, we fought a lot. And then I met Michael and then started to study Systema.
Great. Okay. And Michael was your primary Systema teacher?
Yes. Yeah. I had some other guys, but I believe Michael primary.
What do you think drew you to study kind of reality-based martial arts, insofar as that's a term? Was it simply kind of required in the military to do reality stuff, or did you feel some other motivation to switch from karate to reality martial arts?
You know, when I study box, when I study karate, I felt some limitation in the moment, because what is good, of course, box and karate, but they have they teach you specific things, and you're not free in your movement. That's what bothers me all the time, because in the box I have to work just with hands, but I like to work with legs, I like to fall, I like to do the different movements.
Yeah,
but they're not allowed you to do this, because a certain competition, right, a sport, they have their own rules. That's why I remember when we studied box, our teacher always tell us, if you want to check yourself, you have to go outside, fight on the street a little bit to see who you are inside yourself. Because as we know, sometimes you do very well in the ring or in a gym, but sometimes you go outside and some people have problems. We have lots of street fights, so that's why I check myself all the time.
Right.
And when I studied karate, I saw limitation too. It's like, it's good, it's nice, but... I don't know, it's when I met Michael, I was shocked, you know, because he showed incredible things without even, how to say, price him. Usually the karate, you have to put a black belt on yourself. You price yourself, you ego. He was so, you know, and what is good about it was so, how to say, too much freedom. Even, you know, that much freedom, it shocks you and makes you a little bit tense, but in a different way. Yes, you cannot hug this, you know, like you cannot eat this. It's very interesting. It surprised me a lot.
So you moved to Canada around 25 years ago, is that right?
Oh. Yeah, around that, yeah, around 30.
And did you move there specifically to teach Systema, or was that something that just happened organically when you arrived?
No, I just came to visit my friend, and then somehow one guy heard about me and invited me, and I showed him my skills, he invited other people, and we start to teach.
It just grew naturally.
Yeah, we don't have any plan. I just come to visit to see, you know, Canada and United States, and then go back to Russia.
Right, gotcha. And how do you feel that Canadian and American martial artists, you have people from all over the world now coming to Toronto, Systema HQ, how have they responded to Systema versus people back in Russia?
Quite positive. Of course, you know, some people, you know, try to check and was suspicious. Because again, like me, right, when I see Michael, I was really, I don't believe he can work like that, right? That's why I understand people, yeah, they come to me. But most of the time it was positive. It was puzzle because it's something new. It's like a, I believe, a system. It's the other end of the martial arts. It's like a teach you completely opposite things on the other people teach you.
Opposite things? Like what?
Opposite. It's like, for example, some people teach how to be tense, how to, you know, they speak about the relaxation, but how they teach, how they move, how they work, I can see it's pure tension there, physically and psychologically. In Systema, they try to avoid this. They try to, from the beginning, to remove that tension inside yourself and, you know, be quite invisible.
Gotcha. That,
If we will talk about, you know, some questions, what you asked, why people, you know, work slow and stuff like that, I will explain that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, we'll definitely get onto that. And it seems like Black Belt Magazine are very interested in finding those things. So, you're known for teaching primarily the self-defense system of Systema, which is in the wider world of martial arts known as a reality martial art, right? I guess in contrast to sport-based martial arts, which are training for competition and for winning, competing generally. So is there any kind of competition in Systema? Does that exist anywhere in Russia or elsewhere?
Like a human, yes. Of course, we sometimes fight with each other, right? Some people touch you, you don't like, you hit him back. It's always like that. But we don't teach to compete with each other because it's create weakness and proudness. For me, at least, you know, I check myself. I did box, I did karate in a high level, right? And it's create too much ego and weakness inside you. And when I remember when I studied Systema and karate together, I understand how weak I was in karate, and Systema actually helped me to fight much, much better because I was relaxed and allowed people to hit me, and I was okay, you know.
Yeah, gotcha. So have you, as a benchmark, sometimes people who come from outside of Systema, right, if they're used to sport-based martial arts, maybe they boxed, maybe they did MMA or jiu-jitsu, something like that, often they kind of use competition as a benchmark, right, of sparring, like, and that's how they try to decide or try to assess how good people are and things like that. Have you ever seen Systema applied in a competitive context? Have you ever seen somebody who's trained Systema who then goes on to maybe wrestle or box or something else?
Well, they do this anyway, you know. Already my students come to some competition, they fight, they like to do this. But for me, everybody who is a smart always study or show Systema movements in his life. Because nobody want to hurt themselves. They want to, you know, move smoothly, you know, relax himself. Because imagine if you just fight once per your life, it makes sense. But if you do this as a professional person, you need to study something what relax you, makes you more stronger, movement more, you know, move more comfortably. And avoid any injury inside yourself. So it means, it's like, you know, when, probably I told you that when you see how soldiers start to train, they do obstacle course all the time. So that's what we do all the time in Systema, up and down, hit, move, roll, right? But if you test, you cannot do it anyway. Imagine if you study karate.
Yes, so it seems like you're saying that even if somebody hasn't formally studied Systema, maybe if they study martial arts for a long time, they just kind of, if they're experienced and they're skilled, they start to embody some principles from Systema anyway. They start to relax more, or they start to work not to help themselves, even sport martial artists.
Yeah, well, it's natural. Nobody, if you're stupid, you'll die anyway, right? It doesn't matter. In a way, right? But if you're okay, of course you start to, you know, look inside you. For example, if you have injury, you cannot fight anyway, right? You need to, you study how to avoid this. And the Systema gives you an example, for example, with breathing. How many people cough? How many people, you know, tell us big, big thank you because they have injury, they cannot walk, or they have some operation inside the body, right? And they, by breathing, they recover themselves so fast.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we often say it's not self-defense if you beat yourself up first, right?
Yeah, no, yeah. Why you need to destroy yourself? What's the point of this?
Sure. Yeah. So if you're watching, if you're watching a sport martial artist working, say a skilled boxer or a wrestler or an MMA fighter or something, can you tell immediately if that person has the kind of skills that will transfer into a real fight? Can you, and if so, how can you tell when somebody has those skills?
No, it's quite obvious, you know, because by law of how they should introduce themselves, by watching TV, by watching, you know, his teacher training, they produce themselves very well. They show who they are, how they talk, how they see it, you know. And some people ask me about this. I said, listen, those people, they're extremely good. They're, you know, strong people. But, you know, they, it's like you show everybody you have a gun. For me, dangerous people when you didn't see them.
Yeah.
That's dangerous people. All the other martial arts, okay, they're strong, this and that, but they give you a chance because they show who they are. What I'm afraid when I didn't see.
Yeah.
For example, very good example, Sergei Ozhireli.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, he can stay with you in a room and you cannot even see him. That's dangerous. Who cares if they're big or small, you know? Listen, that's what people develop, knife, a gun, right? You can shoot, whatever, do something, right? But when you didn't see people, that's what scares me.
Gotcha. Yeah. So on that basis, how do you feel like a self-defense art fundamentally differs from a competition art? How is reality-based training different to sport-based training? What kinds of things do reality martial artists have to consider that sport-based martial artists don't?
Sport is good too, you know, the self-defense is good. It just depends what people like to do, because it's good to study something to protect yourself, and you do physical work anyway, you know, you do push-ups, sit-ups, something, you work towards yourself.
Hmm.
But then this is tricky thing, Sam. See, for example, when you're young, of course you want to compete, you want to do, you know, you want to check yourself by energy, by, you know, whatever,
yeah.
By your girlfriend, by your friends. But, you know, some people push. It's like sometimes you don't fight for yourself, right? You fight sometimes for your friends, for your country, right? Sometimes you do need to do this, but some people push you towards the fight. So it's not you. But self-defense, it's you, right? It's like you need to protect yourself. You do need to, prove. You need to see how you can survive in different situation in a nice way to protect yourself, protect your family, like again, protect your country. But your tactical things a little bit different.
Mm.
Because for me, when I want to protect myself, I want to see what's around me and what happened, why I got in that situation where already physical contact will be. And I want to do everything to not avoid this, but to prepare yourself for a fight.
Hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
Not to compete, because competition, it's 2, 3, 4 guys, they will, you know, give you a problem, right?
To all our listeners and Systema fans around the world, NC Systema have moved all of our regular classes online, live streaming group classes via Zoom, most days at 6:30 p.m. US Eastern Standard Time, plus daytime classes on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Sundays. Please consider this an open invitation for you and your students to join us for the duration of COVID, to come together online, and to keep our skills and our groups alive. Payment is on a sliding scale relative to where you're at and what you can afford. Visit ncsystema.com/online to sign up today. Join us. So there are big tactical differences in kind of sport-based and reality martial arts, right? I mean, you've trained both civilians and kind of military operators on how to work mm-hmm. through real situations. And it seems kind of like that for civilians or people in sports situations, people in military situations, sometimes it's you'd rather have avoided the conflict, right? And then sometimes if you're in a military situation or law enforcement, you have to initiate, you have to be in the conflict. Is the training different for people who are using martial arts for a civilian purpose or for professional purpose?
You know, it's quite hard to explain. when you study Systema from the beginning, for example, they teach you always how to relax, right, and feel comfortable to any position.
Hmm.
bad position, wrong position. Sometimes people bend you. You know how to breathe. You know how to relax. You're okay. And in this situation, less aggressiveness comes inside you, and you can control yourself and the other people much more. So it means you don't speculate on like show how good you are, stuff like that. Because when you study sport, they teach you how to be first, right? They wanna, you know, they push you always. Oh, please, you know, show how good you are, this and that. And based everything on ego. When we study, for example, in a military situation, when I have good officers, they teach you to be, how to say, to be strong, to be brave, but not to be, how to say, egoistical things, or I can go here, I can, you know, that's what I want to explain sometimes. Imagine, you see the Rambo, right, movie?
Yeah.
It's in a good example when the person stand up and start to shoot the other people, right? And the people shoot towards him. Of course, nobody touch him. But in reality, no, it's just an example. In reality, imagine you're with a group, like a 10 guys, and suddenly one person stand up and start to shoot around. So when the people shoot back, they shoot exactly in that place where the other people also.
Right.
So it means he provoke the other people shoot towards you. So it means he's a very bad person. Instead of to hide, instead of to, you know, to help the other people, he provoke the other people to do the, to put grenade there or shoot towards you, right? So that's sometimes in a conflict, you want to, in a good situation, some people ask why you work, you know, why you don't fight, why people cannot fight against you. Because everything, what Michael explained, and now I understand, everything what you do, you want to be invisible. No, imagine if the people has weapons or something, and you start to scream, they will shoot towards you, right?
Just to clarify, Vladimir's replying to the question, why don't Systema practitioners go and compete?
Yeah.
We get that question from time to time.
Yeah.
And the answer is, because that's not what our objective is.
So to that end, is there, do you feel like people should train both sport and reality-based martial arts, or does training both kind of hinder your development? Because it seems like in some sport martial arts, for example, as you said, it's important to attack constantly, to stay close, and you get points for being the aggressive or the dominant fighter, right? If you're in a wrestling match or MMA match or something, or boxing matches, how many times you throw punches and things like that. But in a reality-based situation, sometimes evasion or escape are better options. So does that put sometimes a sport-based martial artist at a tactical disadvantage? They have like the wrong mindset, like, and you would rather be invisible and escape and train for that kind of mindset instead?
No. In a good way, of course, the best way to stay invisible, right? It means like a escape, but it's so hard to do, right? Because we have our own ego, weakness, and of course we start to argue with people. Of course we want to punch them, but and I don't know how to explain, but people fight anyway, you know.
Okay. So we should prepare for both.
I think so, yeah. Because that's why you need to come to martial arts to check. That's why we hit each other a little bit, right? Just to see how your body reacts, right? To how you, if you can protect yourself.
Yeah.
Not with arms, not with legs, with your own body, with breathing. Anyway, no, I think it's good to check. I like to move. I like to spar. I like to do these things. I like it. It just, if I see ego comes, that's what makes me, you know, worried about me, because it's not good, because it's not me anymore.
So so there's quite a lot of emphasis on conditioning in Systema, but it seems to me that the emphasis is a little different. In sport-based martial arts, most of the conditioning is kind of aerobic training, like cardio, running, road work, and maybe some strength stuff, kettlebells, things like that, to get make you strong and give you endurance so that you can, you know, fight for many rounds and win this way. How important is fitness to a person who's doing a self-defense art, do you think?
Well, of course it's important. It just depends what you do, right? Some fitness. See, sometimes you see that people train, and then three rounds or one round, they're dead. They cannot move. I don't know how they train if they, after 3 minutes, they already cannot move. My wife will explain.
Basically, endurance is very important for both, for athletes and for self-defense.
Mm.
And even though the fights don't last very long, usually just a few seconds,
yeah.
But endurance training stabilizes your psyche.
Mm.
And that is the most important component. So a self-defense person who has good endurance, he's stable psychologically. He won't panic. He won't freeze in a fight. And he'll be able to defeat the opponent.
And when we train, right, as you know, we do have all levels of work on the ground, work in the middle, we work stand up, we work against one person, two person. So we're not allowed our muscles to be tense in one direction.
Hmm.
Means all group of muscles start to work and they help each other. When we train, all the other group of muscles work and they help each other.
Hmm.
Right? And then any slow exercises, the best, because you fight against yourself immediately.
So, yeah, that seems to tie in with a trend now, I think, in boxing training and MMA and jiu-jitsu, where people are training what they call functional strength, right? Instead of just weight training over and over again. People have realized that freedom of movement is very, very important as well as strength. And if you just keep lifting weights in one direction, you get very strong. Maybe you can push very strong, but you can't pull, or you can pull, but maybe you can't pull at an angle, things like that. So you feel like stability and mobility are as important as strength. Are there other physical attributes that are very, very important for self-defense?
Diverse setting is extremely important, right? So that as much variety as possible. Different movements, different muscle groups, different workloads, and plus the different settings, like what we do at camp. We work in the field, work in the forest, uneven terrains, climate challenges, fight in the middle of the night. So all these, the more variety and challenge for the body and for the mind, for the psyche, the better. It just develops the person so much, makes him aware of himself, and the skill grows much faster.
Gotcha.
And that's why we do these camps in 6 days, probably equivalent to maybe 3 months of regular training in the gym.
Yeah, I can personally attest to that. I've done two of those training camps so far, and I'm planning on coming to the one this year as well. And it's interesting how if you go all out early in the morning and you're too keen, you can run out of gas. So it's like if you spread your effort out throughout the day, then you can sustain 10 hours of training and until the evening and the different environments. And you feel so strong and so healthy after 6 days of that training. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's hard for people to understand because they train to make themselves tired.
Hmm.
Not even stronger. Because they have, in a way, some stress. Right, and they want to remove the stress by doing this certain exercise. But then, they didn't breathe. They didn't, they make them tired and they're happy. So it's the other stress. It's not like you remove the stress. Because after training, you need to feel yourself even better, right? It's like you're supposed to have more energy.
Okay, so training in endurance is important for self-defense students and sports students, but it's how you train that endurance is important, I think.
Yeah, it's just not that many people explain. That's what I like about Michael Rapko. He's an incredibly, wise person. He explains so many different things, and it makes sense, because I feel, for example, I'm 60 now, right? And I feel sometimes better than I'm, 30. There was lots of injury and stuff like that. Inside, I'm more relaxed now. My body, I can move, I can, just maybe start to be lazy, I understand, but, but sometimes I can do rolls in a moment, it's no problem. Imagine, 60 years old, and I have some students, 65, 74, they just happy to, work with young people, and they quite the same, the body start to be more and more alike, not heavy.
Yeah. Yeah, Systema seems very sustainable. It grows with you, and you can both keep your body healthy and strong, and you can also adjust the way you move as you get older, right? And some styles don't allow for that, it seems.
For sure.
So coming on to the kind of the reality aspects of training. So sometimes martial artists from other styles see Systema clips on YouTube, and they comment that everything looks too relaxed, right? That people look like they aren't trying hard enough or training aggressively enough in terms of speed and intensity. What would you say to that?
Well, first, right, they see that we are relaxed. Imagine, so good. Why to be tense? I don't understand that. Because tension is just visible things, and people understand that, right? But if you relax, they worry. They think, why is the person not tense? Why he's not afraid, right? Imagine how many times you see that clips, or if you even when you fight on the street, when the person relax, smile, then suddenly a punch comes and you're out. And you don't see that. You know, if the person starts to be tense, you start to be worried, and you start to whatever, prepare yourself for a fight. So that's first answer. Why to be tense? For what? You know, to scare yourself more. Because any tension, it's create tunnel vision, right? That's it. You start to be, you know, like a very weak. You didn't see people around you. You cannot scream. You cannot do anything, you know. So, and the second part, for example, with Michael, right? When the people come to him, I can talk about myself. You know, sometimes he's quite inside, different than the other people. And when you come to him, he comes to the fog. You know, it's for me, everything. If you're a normal person, when you don't know something, you start to work a little bit slower, right? For example, if you're in a dark room, you don't run through the room.
Yeah.
You start to work slowly. You try to, you know, understand what's in front of you. Because, again, for example, when Michael hit you, it was like in a way like a shock, right? Because he hits so different. You know, I understand Mike Tyson can hit stuff like that. When we didn't box, some people hit me very, very hard. But him, it's something different. Sometimes people come to Michael, right? They, I don't know, something inside them do not push them forward. You know, because something tells you, listen, don't rush, because it will hurt.
So he makes it. Makes you cautious.
Something, you know, yeah, because so many times I saw some very brave people, very high, you know, high level. And I remember Michael broke a couple, you know, what, ribs in front of me, was knee. And he always tell people, don't rush, please, you know. But people think he's afraid. But don't rush, it means for them, he can do movement, but it's like a, you cannot protect yourself. It seems like when you run to the wall, if you run with one speed, run with the other speed, and slowly, you don't hurt yourself. Imagine if you run to the wall and you hurt yourself. The people tell you, why you run full speed to the wall? You're that stupid. That's what Michael said. Don't rush, because certain movements I can control. But in certain situation, that's it, will be end for you. Remember, one guy grabbed Michael, he was a Sambo practitioner, and turned Michael, like he wants to throw him over the shoulder, over the hips, you know, the normal grip. When a person grabs you, turn like a judo or something.
Yeah.
And Michael just put the hand on his ribs, and the ribs was popped out. That's his own movement. Michael just put the arm there, but he turned himself so hard, twisted, and the ribs was, it was in front of me. He started to, Michael said, listen, I told you not to rush. No, it was in front of me. It's not like, a, you know, it's not a story, something. It was in front of me. It was a couple times like that. Don't rush. I said, oh, maybe he's afraid, you know. No, because certain situation, you cannot escape. That's why some people come to him and they start to see that, well, you know, maybe, you know, it's better to control. Because I want to see what happens. What's the big deal to come and the person hit you and that's it? What's the point? It's not competition. I come to study something.
So I think that's maybe something that people miss when they watch slow training on YouTube or something, that the fact that we train at slower speeds and lower intensity sometimes in order to practice relaxation and to be able to see more, right? See ourselves, see our opponent and see how we react, see ourselves and all of that.
Yeah. And too many things you do right away, right? It's not just, for example, I do one punch towards your face and you escape. I do every time. Every time it's different. We don't have bells, anything, you know, big, small guys. Everybody has their own experience. Lots of boxers comes, judo practitioners, sambo. Every time you check yourself how good you are. right? Mm. Because every time you see a person in front of you and you want to show him movement, you check yourself, because it's like you're in a minefield, you know, it's like a, you see who's, you know, who's good, who's bad, and you always respect people this way. You cannot say, oh, this small guy, stuff like that. I remember one small guy break couple jaw in front of me, and I don't even understand how he did that. And now after that, I respect all small people right away. Small, nice, but pom pom, and that's it. See, when you train like that, you always, you know, check yourself how good you are. When you do the technique, of course, people help you, stuff like that or something. Here, I want to work a little bit slower to understand. Hmm. Fast, no problem. Go outside. I check myself a lot. Go outside and you will see. I remember the story. One guy was 60. He got prisoned in Mexico.
Yeah, it was very interesting. One of our students who trains at the school in Toronto here, he was on vacation in Mexico. One of the guys on the resort wasn't very nice to his child. So he got into a fight.
Hmm.
And he was arrested for this. He was offered to pay off $1,000 or something, right? So Mexicans would let him go.
Mm.
But he refused because he didn't feel he was at fault. So he was put into jail there with the local criminals. And somehow, using Sistema, although they attacked him in the cell,
against 20 people, yeah.
He fought, and they left him alone. He was moving constantly and breathing, and he got away from it. And even ended up beating up some people in the cell, so he was moved to another cell.
Start to fight there too.
And then what he did, he used the Sistema breathing
to
escalate his blood pressure. And he claimed that that's it. He's having serious health issues. They took his blood pressure and it was extremely high. So they let him go. They didn't want this trouble on their hands. So they kicked him out.
Wow. Smart move. Very smart. Several levels of control there have been shown, you know, just being surviving in a confined space, changing his own physiology. There's so much packed in there.
Yeah, but he's 60, right? Imagine if you study karate or something, how you can do that in a small room.
Yeah.
With beds or something. It's impossible.
Yeah. Proof of concept. I'd like to take a minute to thank everyone who has contributed to the show, all our listeners, and to everyone who's offered requests, encouragement, and feedback along the way. I also need to ask a quick favor. We have already enjoyed 2 years of high-quality interviews, insights, and ideas on Systema for Life. We'd like to keep the show going, and we want to keep it open to all, but we need your help to do it. It takes time, effort, and more than little cash to produce a podcast. More than $2,000 a year at current hosting and production rates. We have no paid advertising, and we do it all off our own backs with help from listeners and generous supporters like you. So if you're a fan of Systema for Life and you get real value from the ideas and the conversations we create, then please take a few minutes now to subscribe at www.ncsystema.com/support. Support at whatever level you feel like you can afford. Even $3 or $5 a month is a help. Think of it as buying us a beer or a cup of coffee once a month for our troubles. So visit ncsystema.com/support and use the buttons on the page to select your preferred monthly or annual support level. You'll receive a confirmation on sign up and you can cancel at any time. Your support really does help ensure the survival of the show. With gratitude, thank you very much. So is there a place for scaling up speed and intensity in Systema? How do we approach scaling up from the slow speeds to real speeds? Is that something that's reserved for more experienced practitioners, or should everyone work at speed like right away?
No, it's up to you. You know, some people will speed up anyway by fear, by something, right? It's like you can tell him work slowly, but they will do, because for them slowly, for me, slowly it's one speed. For you, maybe slowly the other speed, right? Mm. For example, when I teach my students any normal exercise in the beginning, for example, they move on the floor, right? They move. I said, okay, move to stretch yourself like that, then speed up, then work as fast as you can.
Mm.
See, because everybody has their own speed, like I said. And everybody start to work faster. And then now you work with that speed when you can control people, the other things. Now work with that speed when you can see not the person around you, the other people. So you need to give always an example when the people study certain things, but with the other part of the life. It's like you study one exercise, and it should be another exercise inside that exercise. For example, I stretch myself, but meanwhile, I stretch even more, you know, do something better in the part of my body. For example, if you tense up your leg, you keep tension, but meanwhile, for example, you move on the floor, you grab people, stuff like that, but you keep tension. So it means you control one part of the body and allow the other part of the body move, for example. But the speed, it's like you can tell people, okay, work with speed. I remember when we studied karate, right? Sometimes the people said, okay, fight. Oh, sorry, we do friendly sparring. And everybody work very, you know, fast and even more dangerous. When the people tell you fight, they right away start to work a little bit slower. Because they understand, now it will be serious. Before we, you know, kick each other, sometimes more injury comes from friendly sparring than from real sparring.
Yeah. So how do you prevent that? How do you prevent sparring in class, like in a self-defense class, from becoming just another type of competition? You know.
Okay, it's two way, right? First, when you do proper exercise, for example, breathing or slow push-ups, slow movements, they remove tension inside you anyway. They fear because you start to feel yourself a little bit different. And then when the people start to work, for example, they start to, you know, fight with each other. Right away, do the group attack. You know, fight inside the crowd. That's it. Everybody start to understand they're nobody.
Ah, gotcha. Yeah, they stop locking on one person.
20 people or 100 people in the gym sometimes. Okay, show how good you are. They destroyed you anyway. Because when you start to hit one person, you start to fight with him. The other people from the back hit you with, you know, with happiness. But it's good, it's no doubt. But when you study too many things, you know, speed is like a, it's a weakness comes. Because you do need to speed up now because I want to investigate myself.
So one of the best ways to train then for self-defense is to be, is to use multiple attackers, be realistic about that, that might happen in a real situation. So you can't just lock in on one person. And it seems like that's one aspect of Systema that we train a lot is multiple attackers and also others like working with weapons, right? If you train sport martial arts empty hand, you might not, be prepared for if somebody has a stick, has a blade, or has a chain. Do you feel like working with weapons is another necessary thing for working for genuine reality-based training?
I believe, of course, it is the best way to train, to have varieties, right? Because what bothers me when the people teach you, oh, you have to run away against from the knife, you have to run away. But sometimes, like we know, sometimes you cannot run away. And usually young people, they have a knife, they can stab you, grab you, they want to, you know, take something from you. When the people teach now martial arts, they move away from reality. For example, before when the people fight with swords, with something, right, they didn't fight as a, hand-to-hand. They fight against military situation right away. Everybody has knife, right? Those days, everybody can hit you with a stick. Not that many people do bare knuckles fight, right? So it means now they forget about this. And of course, I understand when they tell you run away, it makes sense for them because they didn't study. They all their training developed for sport. It's not like a I'm against the sport. It just it's a certain training.
Yeah.
And it allowed you to come in a military situation when the people start to shoot and you have to go down. Some people start to, you know, take a knife and instead of the escape, we start to look around or something. So it means they didn't teach you how to look properly towards the people, how dangerous situation can be.
Yeah.
When we train, we always have metal knives. Maybe not that sharp, but for sure they can cut you. They can, you know, do certain damage to you. And then you always respect him, his movement, his knife. And of course, you do much better move because you cannot now run to the knife and because he can stab you. You develop that ability to escape against the knife with different movements, I believe. And the gun, the same situation, and the chain. We work against chain a lot, I remember, in Russia.
So, yeah, there was something in one of your recent knife mastery downloads or DVDs, which I thought was really insightful, which is that even if you want to run away from a knife, people don't even know how to run away, right? Maybe they'll freeze and they'll be stuck, and they can't, if they don't practice seeing and moving, then they'll get stuck and frozen in the, when they see a real weapon.
It depends on the situation. Sometimes you're in a dark street, you turn and hit tree, right? That's why military, guys train a lot, right? They do explosive everything just to see how your body reacts, how to not destroy yourself, right? Of course, it's good to run away. It's no doubt. But please try at least, you know.
Yeah. I remember how at camp when we were practicing confrontation. So when people in a huge open field, plenty of room to run, attacker comes with a knife and people can't run away.
He cut several guys right away.
Yeah.
They cannot, and they're okay, right? They cannot.
And sometimes the attack is with screaming and lots of warning, and still people hesitate and stumble and can't run properly. Yeah. It's really amazing. Yeah, everyone should experience that.
I've seen this myself when I lived in Scotland. Sometimes there were lots of fights in Scotland in the streets, and I knew competent martial artists, people who were good at boxing or, karate or something. And when they were faced with a real conflict or they were threatened with a weapon, they froze and they were unable to use the techniques that they had. And afterwards they're like, oh, I should have done this and I should have done that. And why didn't I do this? But at the time when they needed it, they were unable to access that response, right? Do you feel like that's because they don't train for that situation? They don't work with breathing, they don't work with how to control their own bodies and their minds?
Look, breathing will help and the proper training helps, because if they teach you how to be tense, of course you will freeze, Imagine you study karate, tension, suddenly small room and that's it, it's hard for you
to hit.
You need to train properly.
Yeah. So one more aspect to this is training striking, because there's a famous quote by Mike Tyson that everybody has a plan until they get punched in the mouth, right? So you can work on your boxing combinations and you can have an amazing double left hook and you'd be hitting the bag for months and months and you're in great condition. And then you get into the ring or outside the ring and somebody punches you and all of your ideas go out of your head, right? Because you're not used to getting hit in some way. So in Systema, we practice like a lot of strike absorption. We allow ourselves to be hit quite hard by partners to an extent that I've never really seen in other styles that I've trained. Do you feel like it's essential for a reality-based martial artist to get hit a lot in training in order to understand what it takes to survive real interactions?
Yeah. Just everything what you said is correct. It means I just want to tell you about Mike Tyson. It was a good sentence, right? When he punched and lots of people forget about his plan, but look how he finished, right? He even bite ear.
Right.
He showed who he is inside, right? He's like that, right? He's a pure hooligan. He's not like a, if something changed, that's what he does. I'm sorry, that's what he did. In a way, when we train a lot, I remember in Russia, Michael didn't hit us a lot, right? We most of the time we play with open hands. We put people, rotate them, move them, because he create better distance. Then when you start to work with the body, your fingers start to be adjustable, and you start to see where the person has tension. And then, for example, when you start to hit people, see why we hit people, because it's easy to explain about our style. Because we hit a little bit different than the other people. We teach people how to take a punch differently than the other styles. So for us, it's much easier to explain, because some people ask, how you explain system? You start to speak about breathing, but everybody breathes. You start to speak about movement, but everybody moves, right? And for lots of people, they don't understand natural movements.
Yeah,
and that's why you hit a person and he right away understand who he is, right?
Basically, before we start studying striking, we have to teach our body to receive strikes.
Yeah.
This is the foundation. if you don't know how to absorb the strike with your body and with breathing, it's going to be a destruction very quickly. You'll be a useless training partner.
Yeah.
That has to be the start of training. And it's first practicing how to stop your partner, then how to push, and then how to strike.
Yeah.
So there's a progression there that makes it a good solid skill.
Yeah, because when the person wants to stop the guy, but his movements, like he want to hit him.
Mm.
So he didn't even have that ability to stop a person normally because his movements too sharp or too dangerous. And that's how a fight starts, right? I want to stop you, suddenly, you know, you see the movements as a threat. It's better to hit people. It's nice.
Yeah. Like yeah, me too. That's it. Yeah, so it's interesting. I think in Systema, it's one of the only styles that I've seen that asks the question, why? You know, what do you want to achieve with hitting the guy? You know, often if you just practice striking the air like you're doing a kata or you just hit a heavy bag, it seems like the motivation is always you hit the guy as hard as you can, as fast as you can to do damage. And that's where the reason ends. But in Systema, often we think about, well, do you want to break his structure? Do you want to remove his will to keep fighting? Do you want to stop his fighting spirit? Do you want to just maneuver him so that you can do something else? There seem to be lots of aspects to striking, and we study in a slightly deeper way, like from the fist backwards almost, right? Rather than just thinking about throwing your fists at things. So that's very interesting to me.
Yeah, you're completely right, Glenn. Seriously, completely right.
Brilliant. So, all of this context in talking about martial arts and training for self-defense, I feel like it's a trap some people can get into sometimes when they train a lot of self-defense and reality martial arts. You know, people do Krav Maga, they do like some other form of kind of military-derived martial art. And there's a danger to becoming paranoid, you know, to seeing threats everywhere that you look, like all the time, right? If you train this way all the time. Do you feel like that's a danger for people doing reality martial arts, and how do you avoid that?
I think so, yeah, because they teach you how to be afraid, right? Because they teach you to be tense. It means they automatically put the fear inside your body.
Mm.
No, look at Krav Maga, right? They're just like they scream on each other. They fight, come on, you know? It's not professional, right? I don't know. They're probably nice people or something, but how they teach, I don't know. It's so bad. From the beginning, they have to teach you. If you see that, for example, you come and the people didn't teach you how to breathe, how you can survive? Mm. Because you cannot even relax yourself. Yeah, everything should be natural. It's like, for me, like a fighting should be like you move. If you walk okay, it means you have to fight exactly the same. If something tension comes inside your body, there's something wrong. Fear comes inside you.
Mm.
So all these elements, what they teach you to do the blocks, to do this, that, for me, it's dangerous. Sometimes even you destroy it yourself without fighting.
Mm.
Because it's like an element when you come, maybe, of course, you're afraid of something. You come to train, and they give you even more fear. Of course, they tell you, no, you destroyed some people, you can hit, stuff like that. But when you see from a side, for me, to be honest with you, it's useless. Because I did karate at a high level, right? Mm. And I'm still afraid. That's why I want to kick much faster, this and that. So it means it's a way to prison, right? It's, you know, you destroyed people because by your own fear, you don't, judge a situation properly. Yeah, you can do too much damage for what, right? Because you're afraid.
Yeah, so it seems that many martial arts schools, the emphasis is learning how to defend yourself from others, from threats all the time. And yet in Systema, we do this, but you're also teaching your students how to defend themselves from the wider threat to destroying themselves, you know, from stress, from anxiety, from bad breathing, from declining health with age and things like that. Is this why we spend so much time teaching people how to calm themselves down before teaching them to fight? Because that's as important. Is it important for health and for combat?
And people live in stress all the time, every day.
Yeah.
So it's important to remove that and not to escalate it. We say a good warrior is a healthy warrior. So it has to be both the body healthy and the psyche, the mind, peace of mind, light heart, all these good things have to be there.
Judging from the current state of the world, do you feel like learning self-defense, real self-defense, is more important than ever or less important?
I believe it's more important, yeah. Because look at what happened now in the world, right? Some people drive the car towards you and certain things, you know, it's when you do sport, it's one thing. So when you do proper training, when the people teach you how to see, like I said, things around you, if the car moves suddenly strange, you need to pay attention to this, not to sit inside yourself, not to think how good you are, how bad I am, what to do. You need to always look around, right? Because suddenly people can attack you and that's it.
Yeah, gotcha. So if somebody's looking to make themselves well-rounded, to be competent and effective in reality for self-defense, and maybe also if they're training for sport martial arts, what are the three most important things you think they need to work on? Is it conditioning and endurance, or is it mindset? Which things are most important?
Our Systema slogan, strength, courage, humility. So that's what we need to develop.
Right? Yeah, that's what I believe, yeah.
Strength, courage, humility, that's a sign of Systema. The last question about the world situation, Michael was saying that because there's so much more terrorism and after 9/11 and the shootings and all these survival threats, there is a great need to study martial arts and self-defense. And he said that people should be more realistic, that a superhero will not fly in to your help. Yeah. You need to save yourself.
Yeah.
And there's so much movies and publicity about the superheroes and all these series about them. But it just leads people in the wrong direction.
Sure. So we're fascinated with this because it comes from fear, maybe, right? People are fearful that they can't take care of themselves and their families. So they seek refuge in these movies, maybe. So is there anything else you'd like to add on the subject?
Our goal in training to relax people around us and ourselves, it's like an angry dog. You don't go aggressively against it. It will attack you even more. Every professional, when he's dealing with an aggressive criminal, he wants to calm him down, not aggravate him. Only as a last resort, you get into a fight, but you try to dissipate it before it becomes a crisis. And sometimes people around a potential fighter provoke him, push him into a conflict. They're trying to tell you, go fight, but that's not necessary. Someone who has been in real fighting experience or military experience will not tell you to go fight.
That makes sense. So that's, I guess, many martial arts train or try to prepare people for strength or even for courage, right, with the way that they fight. But the humility then becomes important, right? If you don't feel like you have to fight, if you can hide your skills or you can avoid if you need to, then that's where it becomes important. You know, fight for pride, you fight for your country or your life.
It's like a good sniper, right? He hides himself, do the job and escape, right?
Right.
it's serious. It's, they want to, they teach you to be, like your friends wants to see you visible. For what? You know, and then the, okay, you hit one person, and then they tell you, hit this guy. And then never ending story, right? And then look at Fyodor Emelianenko, right? This good job, couple times you lose, everybody start to criticize him, right? That's to live for the other people, so useless, you know. To help them, yes, but to impress them, no way.
Right. That sounds like solid advice. Well, I think that's about all we got time for. But thank you very, very much for taking the time, Vladimir, and to Valerie for fleshing all of that out. And we will look forward to hearing more from you in the future. And if people want to find out about the immersion camp, so it's Fit to Fight, it's called this year?
In August, and we've started registration. And we're going to do maybe film some more podcasts while we're at camp.
Excellent. Great. Well,
bye from the scene.
Excellent. I'll be there. I'm signing up this week, so I'll look forward to seeing you all at the camp.
Thank you so much, Glenn.
Thank you, Gloria. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for listening. If you'd like to find out more about classes, workshops, and seminars at NC Systema, please visit us online at www.ncsystema.com.